insiders, fighting for insiders. Time to... On episode 3 of Tross Chats, I made the bold and unwarranted claim that Mencius Moldbug's concept of the cathedral lends many concepts from Louis Althusser's work. That claim also implied that Althusser conducted an analysis of the cathedral from a Marxist lens. Although I had never read any of Althusser's work, I made this claim. I wish to rectify this claim in this video by going over Althusser's cathedral, the ideological state apparatuses. Louis Althusser was a French communist that was very active in the 1960s and 1970s. As a Marxist academic, Althusser spent most of his career analyzing the works of Marx, while injecting structuralist linguistics and Freudian and Lacanian psychoanalysis into his work. He was also a spiritual successor of communist philosopher and bureaucratic subversive Antonio Gramsci. Althusser's most famous piece is his essay, Ideology and Ideological State Apparatuses, Notes Towards an Investigation. In this essay, Althusser grapples with the fundamental question of how the means of production reproduce themselves materially and socially. His theories and analysis roughly try to explain how state and non-state institutions uphold the status quo through state force and subtle mimetic propaganda. How do economic machines continue justifying their existence in the social realm? Althusser poses the following parameters, quote, "In order to exist, every social formation must reproduce the conditions of its production at the same time as it produces and in order to be able to produce. It must therefore produce, 1, the productive forces, 2, the existing relations of production," unquote. He asserts that people require basic necessities to continue existing and in order to continue fueling economic machines of productive industry, but subsistence also must include historically and materially derived entertainment and meta-narratives. Quote, "Remember that this quantity of value, wages, necessary for the reproduction of labor value is determined not by the needs of a biological guaranteed minimum wage alone, but by the needs of a historical minimum. Marx noted that English workers need beer while French proletarians need wine, i.e. historically variable minimum," unquote. Obviously, societies around the globe have developed different cultures and ways of doing things. Different people have different geographically and economically determined diets and habits. But how are these diets and habits codified? Workers need to be socialized on how to be good machine operators and how to be good machine caretakers before and after their shift ends as a basic means of survival. Quote, "Besides these techniques and knowledges, and in learning them, children at school must learn the rules of good behavior, i.e., the attitude that should be observed by every agent in the division of labor, according to the job he is destined for. Rules of morality, civic and professional conscience, which means the rules of respect for the socio-technical division of labor, and ultimately the rules of the order established by class domination. They also must learn to speak proper French, to handle the workers correctly, i.e. actually for the future capitalists and their servants, to order them about properly, i.e. ideally to speak to them in the right way," unquote. He recaps that, quote, "The reproduction of labor power requires not only a reproduction of its skills, but also at the same time a reproduction of its submission to the rules of the established order, i.e. a reproduction of submission to the ruling ideology for the workers, and a reproduction of the ability to manipulate the ruling ideology correctly for the agents of exploitation and repression so that they too will provide the domination of the ruling class in words," unquote. But how are the rules and material maintenance of the establishment upheld? Althusser creates the dichotomy of repressive state apparatuses, RSAs, and ideological state apparatuses, ISAs. He describes the Marxist view of the nature of the state first. Quote, "The state is explicitly conceived of as a repressive apparatus. The state is a machine of repression, which enables the ruling classes in the 19th century, the bourgeois class, and the class of big landowners to ensure their domination over the working class, thus enabling the former to subject the latter to the process of surplus value extortion, i.e. to capitalist exploitation, unquote. The state has been an ever-present feature of human societies. As a Marxist, Althusser takes the Hegelian dialectic materialist view of history, with the addition of Marx's underlying theme of class struggle. To a Marxist, all history is the record of class struggle, from the struggle against pre-modern slavery to the struggle against feudal aristocracy to the current struggle against bourgeois capitalism. The most recent transition from feudalism to capitalism features the state transitioning from the embodiment of the will of the aristocracy to the bourgeoisie under the guise of representing mass man democratically. Quote, as is provided by bourgeois revolutions of the 19th century, France, 1830-1848, by coup d'etat, 2nd of December, May, 1958, by collapses of the state, the fall of the empire in 1870, of the Third Republic in 1940, or by the political rise of the petty bourgeoisie, 1890-95 in France, etc., without the state apparatus being affected or modified, it may survive political events which affect the possession of state power. Even after a social revolution like that of 1917, a large part of the state apparatus survived after the seizure of state power by the alliance of the proletariat and the small peasantry. Lenin repeated the fact again and again, unquote. Although the state consists of the repressive actions of the ruling coalition of partisan factions, the state is much more than repression. It is also the sociocultural means of reproducing itself. Quote, in order to advance the theory of the state, it is indispensable to take into account not only the distinction between state power and state apparatus, but it also is clearly on the side of the repressive state apparatus, but must not be confused with it. I shall call this reality by its concept, the ideological state apparatuses, unquote. Quote, remember that in Marxist theory, the state apparatus, SA, contains the government, the administration, the army, the police, the courts, the prison, etc., which constitute what I shall in the future call the repressive state apparatus. Repressive suggests that the state apparatus in question functions by violence, at least ultimately, since repression, e.g. administrative repression, may take non-physical forms. I shall call ideological state apparatuses a certain number of realities which present themselves to the immediate observer in the form of distinct and specialized institutions. I propose an empirical list of these which will obviously have to be examined in detail, tested, corrected, and reorganized. All of the reservations implied by this requirement, we can for the moment regard the following institutions as ideological state apparatuses. The order in which I have listed them has no particular significance. The religious ISA, the system of different churches. The educational ISA, the system of different public and private schools. The family ISA, the legal ISA, the political ISA, the political system including the different parties, the trade union ISA, the communications ISA, press, radio, television, etc., the cultural ISA, literature, the arts, sports, etc., unquote. To Althusser, the distinction between public and private ideological state apparatuses doesn't really make a difference. In terms of function, the British BBC does roughly the same thing as the American CNN, with the only distinction being funding and ownership. Quote, the distinction between public and private is a distinction internal to bourgeois law, invalid in the subordinate domains in which bourgeois law exercises its authority. The domain of the state escapes it because the latter is above the law. The state, which is the state of the ruling class, is neither public nor private. On the contrary, it is the precondition for any distinction between public and private. The same thing can be said from the starting point of our state ideological apparatuses. It is unimportant whether the institutions in which they are realized are public or private. What matters is how they function. Private institutions can perfectly well function as ideological state apparatuses. Unquote. To my knowledge, no class can hold state power over a long period without, at the same time, exercising its hegemony over and in the state ideological apparatuses, I need one example and proof of this. Lenin's anguished concern to revolutionize the educational ideological state apparatus, among others, simply to make it possible for the Soviet proletariat who seized state power to secure the future of the dictatorship of the proletariat and transition into socialism, unquote. The impact of the repressive and ideological state apparatuses is quite clear. If the reigning ideology in the West is progressivism, and progressivism maintains a stronghold over the supermajority of ideological state apparatuses, a capitalist progressive social democratic party need only to gain power in a very brief amount of time to do incredible amounts of damage. You will almost never see a welfare system get repealed provided an economic collapse or soft reset happens. The state almost never gives up its direct or indirect regulatory power over its economy or populace. An Althusser power analysis through a Mobugian lens would identify the cathedral as the hegemonic ruler over the repressive red and blue apparatuses and ideological, media, and educational apparatuses. The Democrats are the current inner party, and the Republicans are the current outer party. The outer party always loses, and the Republicans will never truly rule without also ideologically ruling schools and the media. The outer party may build a coalition large enough to rule portions of the repressive apparatus, but they are all doomed to fail. Althusser's analysis also suggests that the media is shielded by the state and vice versa. Quote, the role of the repressive state apparatus, insofar as it is a repressive apparatus, consists essentially in securing by force, physical or otherwise, the political conditions for the reproduction of the relations of production, which are in the last resort relations of exploitation. Not only does the state apparatus contribute generously to its own reproduction. The capitalist state contains political dynasties, military dynasties, etc., but also and above all, the state apparatus secures by repression from the most brutal physical force via mere administrative commands and interdictions to open and tacit censorship, the political conditions for the action of the ideological state apparatuses. In fact, it is the latter which largely secure the reproduction specifically of the relations of production behind a shield provided by the repressive state apparatus. It is here that the role of the ruling ideology is heavily concentrated. The ideology of the ruling class, which holds state power. It is the intermediation of the ruling ideology that ensures a sometimes teeth-gritting harmony between the repressive state apparatus and the ideological state apparatus, and between the different state ideological apparatuses, unquote. Quote, indeed, we have listed a relatively large number of ideological state apparatuses in contemporary capitalist social formations. The educational apparatus, the religious apparatus, the family apparatus, the political apparatus, the trade union apparatus, the communications apparatus, the cultural apparatus, etc., unquote. All material conditions and relations are defined by their utility in the production and consumption machines. The origins of the specific reigning ISAs are very similar to Moebug's anti-clericalist radical reformation origins of the cathedral. Quote, in the pre-capitalist historical period, which I have examined extremely broadly, it is absolutely clear that there was one dominant ideological state apparatus, the church, which concentrated within not only religious functions, but also educational ones, and a large proportion of the functions of communications and culture. It is no accident that all ideological struggle from the 16th century to the 18th century, starting with the first shocks of the Reformation, was concentrated in an anti-clerical and anti-religious struggle. Rather, this is a function precisely of the dominant position of the religious ideological state apparatus. The foremost objective and achievement of the French Revolution was not just to transfer state power from the feudal aristocracy to the merchant capitalist bourgeoisie, to break part of the former repressive state apparatus and replace it with a new one, e.g. the National Popular Army, but also to attack the number one ideological state apparatus, the church. Hence, the civil constitution of the clergy, the confiscation of ecclesiastical wealth, and the creation of a new ideological state apparatus to replace the religious ideological state apparatus in its dominant role. Unquote. The old way of controlling masses was through the church and through the patriarchal family. The new way of controlling the masses is through education and an altered family structure. People are not only educated in school, but also educated on social media and by Adorno's conception of the late stage capitalist culture industry. Quote, between the family state apparatus and the educational state apparatus, it drums into them, whether it uses old or new methods, a certain amount of know-how wrapped in the ruling ideology, French, arithmetic, natural history, the sciences, literature, or simply the ruling ideology of its pure state, ethics, civic instruction, philosophy, unquote. Quote, in fact, the church has been replaced today in its role as dominant ideological state apparatus by the school. It is coupled with the family as the church was once coupled with the family. We now claim that the unprecedentedly deep crisis, which is now shaking the educational system of so many states around the globe, often in conjunction with a crisis already proclaimed in the Communist Manifesto, shaking the family system, takes on a political meaning, given that the school and the school family couple constitutes the dominant ideological state apparatus, the apparatus playing a determinant role in the reproduction of the relations of production, of a mode of production threatened in its existence by the world class struggle. Unquote. All hail the ideological state apparatus of YouTube. All hail the repressive apparatus. Quote, the political apparatus, by subjecting individuals to the political state ideology, the indirect parliamentary or direct plebiscitarian or fascist democratic ideology. The communications apparatus, by cramming every citizen with daily doses of nationalism, chauvinism, liberalism, moralism, etc., by means of the press, the radio, and television. The same goes for the cultural apparatuses. The role of sport in chauvinism is of first importance, etc. The religious apparatus, by recalling in sermons and other great ceremonies of birth, marriage, and death, that man is only ashes unless he loves his neighbor to the extent of turning the other cheek to whoever strikes first. The family apparatus, but there is no need to go on. Unquote. These interpretations of the role of ideological indoctrination are all well and good, but Althusser wants to further examine the origins of ideology in order to fully understand what we are dealing with. Althusser asserts the two predominant Marxist views of ideology, that man constructs ideologies to represent the imaginary relationship of individuals to their real conditions of existence, or ideology has a material existence. The former goes as follows, quote, we commonly call religious ideology, ethical ideology, legal ideology, political ideology, etc., so many world outlooks. Of course, assuming that we do not live one of these ideologies as the truth, e.g. believe in God, duty, justice, etc., we admit that the ideology we are discussing from a critical point of view, examining it as the ethnologist examines the myths of a primitive society, that these world outlooks are largely imaginary, i.e. does not correspond with reality. To Feuerbach, for example, God is the essence of real man. The essential point is that on condition that we interpret the imaginary transposition and inversion of ideology, we arrive at the conclusion that in ideology, men represent their real conditions of existence to themselves as an imaginary form. This is how, in The Jewish Question and elsewhere, Marx defends the Feuerbachian idea that men make themselves an alienated or imaginary representation of their conditions of existence, because these conditions of existence are themselves alienated. In the 1844 manuscripts, because these conditions are dominated by the essence of alienated society, alienated labor, unquote. Conversely, the material origins of ideology goes something like this, quote, the individual in question behaves in such and such a way, adopts such and such a practical attitude, and, what is more, participates in certain regular practices, which are those of the ideological apparatus on which depend on the ideas which he has in all consciousness freely chosen as a subject. If he believes in God, he goes to church to attend mass, kneels, prays, confesses, does penance once it was material in the ordinary sense of the term, and naturally repents and so on. If he believes in duty, he will have the corresponding attitudes, inscribing in ritual practices according to the correct principles. If he believes in justice, he will submit unconditionally to the rules of the law and may even protest when they are violated, sign petitions, take part in a demonstration, etc. Unquote. Societies either create ideologies to reflect their relationship to the means of production, or the means of production imprint morality onto their caretakers. Quote, in every case, the ideology of ideology thus recognizes, despite its imaginary distortion, that the ideas of a human subject exist in his actions, or ought to exist in his actions, and if that is not the case, it lends him other ideas corresponding to the actions, however perverse, that he does perform. This ideology talks of actions. I shall talk of actions inserted into practices, and I shall point out that these practices are governed by the rituals in which these practices are inscribed, within the material existence of an ideological apparatus, be it only a small part of the apparatus, a small mass in a small church, a funeral, a minor match at a sports club, a school's day, a political party meeting, etc. Unquote. Althusser then goes on to explain the structuralist linguistics of ideologies, and after he is done with that, he ends his essay with a call to action. Quote, it is only from the point of view of the classes, i.e., of the class struggle, that it is possible to explain the ideologies existing in a social formation. Not only is it from the starting point that it is possible to explain the realization of the ruling ideology in the ISAs and of the forms of class struggle for which the ISAs are the seat and the stake, but it is also and above all from this starting point that it is possible to understand the provenance of the ideologies which are realized in the ISAs and confront one another there. For if it is true that the ISAs represent the form in which the ideology of the ruling class must necessarily be realized, and the form in which the ideology of the ruling class must necessarily be measured and confronted, ideologies are not born in the ISAs, but from the social classes at grips in the class struggle, from their conditions of existence, their practices, their experience of the struggle, etc. Unquote. That is the essay, Ideology and Ideological Estate Apparatuses. But where does that leave us? Althusser and many Marxists hold an extremely pessimistic view of the interfaces that make life worth living to many people. Althusser has reduced all material and spiritual conditions of man into simple production, consumption, and reproduction, stripping all transcendent meaning from any sort of normative value judgments. In this worldview, all of the stories we tell ourselves to make our lives just a little bit more bearable are lies. Family, religion, nation, home, all of these are just a nice paint job over the real material conditions and relations. You are an ant telling yourself that you are not just acting, but living. What is the purpose of life to a Marxist beyond carrying out production, consumption, and reproduction? To a Marxist, value is being unfairly extracted from workers by the capitalist class. So, the goal of the Marxist is praxis. Socialize the means of production and liberate individuals from their individual responsibilities. Morality is just another paint job over a rotten structure. Perhaps the meaning of life to a Marxist is not moral nihilism, but hedonism. So, egoism? Althusser's essay does not make any value judgments, or propose any solution to the supposed problem of exploitation. His analysis does, however, stress the importance of controlling the repressive and ideological state apparatuses. If you want your political ideology to dominate hegemonically, you must seize the means of ideological reproduction. You must pack schools with your useful idiot teachers. You must ensure that families instill their children with your virtues. And you must take down all enemy ideological propaganda on social media and in the culture industry. What people see on TV and learn in school matters. Politics is war by just another means. If your political movement does not fight to be seen and heard, it will die. Free speech is an illusion. The open society is a hopelessly naive illusion. If you want to see a future in which your ideal material conditions are dominant, you must shut down your enemies both ideologically and politically. To the Trotskyist, the purpose of leftist politics is eternal class struggle, the war of man against man for all eternity in order to perpetually improve the lives of the masses, regardless of the number of dead bodies. To quote Jonathan Bowden, the Marxists want to, quote, redeem the soul of man, but they don't believe that man has a soul, unquote. The limp-wristed conservatives of today are either unwilling or unable to replace the reigning ideological episteme. About 60 years ago, left and right philosophers could have a dialogue with each other in academia, but now, the damn Buckleyite soft conservatives have severed the ideological wing of their movement from themselves. The political left certainly don't have a problem with platforming socialist, communists, and other ideological dregs, but as soon as the right platforms someone as tepid and ideologically harmless as Jordan Peterson or Dave Rubin, they get shut down by their own side. That is why I am concerned about the future. That is why I made this video. I want you to know the importance of controlling the ideological state apparatuses, because these are the weapons of democratic politics. Politics is more than voting. Everything is political, and every item in the media is part of an ideological war being fought. I just wish someone would fight this war with me. Anyway, thanks for watching.